Hello everybody, I am Niharika and
I'm Manas.
And we are from India, which is still a developing country. And we have been contributing towards open source for about 2 to 3 years now. And while we were having fun doing that, we definitely faced a lot of limitations and resistance, as I would like to say. But it wasn't, so this talk is as highly personalized as it is, it's also a very general view of what's the kind of situation that actually prevails in mostly India, but there are some
Southeast Asia.
Right. So there are some really strong talking points for other nations, or other developing nations, which don't currently hold as much truly for India. And by that I mean like for Africa, it's a whole new situation, but in India, it is, in India and Southeast Asia, it's a little more prevalent than most.
And all these things have like limited us in what we could have achieved rather in those 2 or 3 years.
Right. So just by a show of hands, how many of you right now think that you're from a developing nation? All right, so that's basically like 50%, which is cool. So we've been claiming all this while that we are from a developing nation. We contribute to open source and we face a lot of limitations. So throughout the talk, we would first talk about what kind of groups are basically being affected by this limitation and what these limitations are. Then we would go on to tell, we would talk about how people definitely thought that, yeah, these are limitations that are happening in the world, so we should overcome that. So they made a lot of student-friendly or people-friendly open source programs
right, to promote more contributions from students.
Students, minorities, or people who just who they thought that should be more involved in open source because everyone wants young developers. And then we would analyze the kind of participation that these student-friendly open source programs receive. And we would find a really interesting trend here. And we would then basically convince you that even though the agenda for these open source programs was a very noble one, somehow it's basically ultimately lacking in its very essence. Something is going very wrong somewhere, which I do not know how much the people who are not in a developing country realize, because we feel that this happens behind the curtain.
The organizers or like it is like a very mentality kind of thing,
right? And these things are something that I do not know if people in developed countries really understand. And then we would just have a general brainstorming session
on how the situation can be improved, what or changes have to be made or can be made.
Right. So like we said, there are two different types of groups that are being affected. These are broadly the ones that we feel are hugely affected by these limitations. The first we would talk about are students. University course structure, values, marks. Let's just take India for an example. The very essence of success in Indian education system means a high pointer, a high GPA, very good marks in your core structure solely. You are basically set for your life. You'll get a job, you'll get married, you'll get set, and that
yes.
is it. You do not, Indian families, Indian parents, Indian mentality does not account for what's happening, what change you're making in the world, because in India, it's a developing country itself, so they think money equals success.
How you are a person doesn't really count. I mean, even during marriage, when proposals come, they do check your mark sheets. It's that kind of
bad. And we're not talking about caste system here, it's a completely different topic.
That's a different
thing. So that, and so over here, pointers make a lot of decision as to who you are as a person, if you're a success or a failure. So let's say, for example, I'm a person who takes time out of my college work and contributes to an open source organization, maybe multiple of them. So I have basically, I have worldly skills. I can contribute to real code in the real world, which is definitely impacting a lot of people. But I am doing this out of my college course structure. So maybe I'm performing averagely in my college coursework. But at the same time, I'm sitting in my place at home locally and making a huge impact. People don't get that. As opposed to there's someone who rote learns college courses day and night, scores a 10 GPA, gets into an IIT, which is basically an MIT for you, but it's like IIT is like the benchmark for success
in
India.
It's like Ivy League school.
Exactly. So for me, we'd really, you know, be personalizing
admissions
here.
Admissions there aren't based on your how you are. Like, for example, if I want to get into computer science at one of these schools, then they would only check my marks in maths and chemistry. I mean, chemistry is not even remotely related to computer science. And however good I am, but I won't get into those. Only those with like good marks in chemistry or physics would get into. It's that kind of thing.
Right. So what we're stressing over here is that we study courses which aren't even relevant to us, and that counts. But when we do things out of the coursework that are relevant to us, the universities do not recognize that at all. So I am an outreachy intern, and it has this concept that I could use my outreachy intern as a university project, but that would only work if my university accepts my outreachy work as a project. The mentality, so that is the fourth point over here. Either faculty is unaware or they're unsupportive. What's happening over here is that, so if we have semester projects or which are either 2 months long or 6 months long, so they expect either a research intern, or they expect an industrial intern, or they expect projects under them which might pertain to machine learning or IoT or anything. But if you go and tell them that I will be contributing to an open source organization, maybe it's Mozilla, which is so highly named, or Fedora, and even if I say that I'm getting paid for it and I'll get a proper internship letter in the end, they just wouldn't recognize it. They would say, nah, not something you would do here, try it out later. It's just that bad.
It's very common everywhere.
So what we are trying to stress over here, that all this while we were saying that, okay, we are contributing to open source, please convert our effort into course credits. And they said, nah. So we're like, okay, fine. We don't want course credits, but at least give us some compensatory leaves. Let us go to conferences. You know, if sugarcoating it, we are kind of representing our college. So be proud and let us do that. And on a good level, we're representing India, and you know, we're being actually productive over here. But they just don't do that. And this is exam, rescheduling exams is one thing. Then there are most of the conferences in USA happen during majority of the colleges' end semester exams, and we just basically don't get to go. So over here, the second group that's affected are freshers or job switchers, which are like people in between jobs. All right, so this is actually very prevalent. I'm back. So in India, there are a lot of financial companies that offer jobs to people right after they graduate, and fintech companies translate to a lot of money just when you start working, but it also translates to what are they really doing? Are they really putting an actual impact in the world? At the same time, these people's way of selecting candidates has nothing to do with your resume. They only go for your pointer. Exactly. So I have sat in so many interviews, Goldman Sachs, Morgan Stanley, JP Morgan Chase. I mean, I could go on and on. And I have this huge resume where I try to list down all my open source contributions, and let's just not even say open source, extracurricular activities, which I know count so much in developed nations because you're putting the effort to do something different from your usual coursework. And they basically put aside all of that, and then they make you sit they expect you to clear their customized coding test in spite of whatever achievements you have in your open source.
Your, your not coding skills, rather your software engineering skills, communication skills, like don't really matter. At the start itself, they will check your grade pointer, and then based on that, they will shortlist you. And with all the other things like attendance and everything, if you are going to work on your actual software engineering skills, then your grade pointer is going to go down.
So I would actually say that 98% of the companies that are in India, even if they're MNCs, they select not looking on your resume. They might shortlist you. I do not know for on what basis again, but it's they just do not care if you have open source contributions. And that, I mean, so that just, I mean, what do we do? You're not supporting us anywhere, but here we are still contributing in spite of all this resistance. Social stigma.
And then the
social stigma. So over here what's happening is that, so now there's this concept of remote jobs, which is so popular in developed nations, I'd say. But if you say remote jobs, I hear Indian parents saying, you don't have a job. That doesn't even qualify.
And you don't need to work, you don't need to get a job. That is what I mean, students don't need that. You should focus on your studies, even though one could balance both equally.
Right. Also, like, I know, as this is a personal thing, if I graduate, if I say that I have a remote job which is paying me more than any other job that I'll, you know, any other industrial job, my mom might even disown me for that matter. I do not know. So, I mean, that basically boils down to the third point, that even it's all extra time that we're taking out to contribute to open source. I know all of you are doing that too, but we just don't have that support, and there's just zero recognition. So conferences like these are somewhere where we understand, yeah. So yes, there's a bigger picture to all of it, so woohoo.
And then there are programs, some of which are local in India, like GirlScript, and there's the Chinese one of Alibaba Summer of Code. And then there are the international ones like Google Summer of Code, Outreaky Rails, Summer of Code, Hacktoberfest. I mean, these programs are supposed to promote, and they do achieve a lot of things, but then when all the other factors come in, I mean, I think some of these programs are very misused. And these are the statistics. And GSOC gets, and this is the student statistics. If you could see, like, India has the highest number of students.
It's 6 times USA.
And every other
country. In spite of the resistance.
And then, if you look at the mentor statistics, like, it's United States is all the way to the top, then Germany, and then India. And the thing here is people, the only reason students are so much compared to everyone else, and they don't continue as mentors. I mean, they have to face such limitations that they can't contribute to programs later. They can't continue their contributions. And you can clearly see that in the mentor statistics. And this is the outreach even, which Niharika knows well.
So over here, okay, right. So I'd like to point out one thing that I'm not saying, I mean, this is not a generalized, I'd like to rephrase that. It's a generalized notion that Indians basically would get attracted to the handsome stipend that Outreachy and Google Summer of Code is giving them. It's also one of the pros that these programs have is that they're very, very flexible, which I absolutely love, which I think you wouldn't get in any industry. Sure, industrial jobs have perks, but this is you get paid handsomely. There's just so many, you get to attend conferences, you get to extend your internships, you have regular talks with your mentors. It's wonderful. But somehow this is being abused.
As you can see, these are the number of applicants that were there. I mean, these are just applicants. And in the next slide,
what?
Okay. We don't have These are the number of applicants, but the actual number of people that are eligible for any, even Outreach or Google Summer of Code, are very less in the end due to all these limitations that come in. People don't have the approved amount of leave, like Outreach has some 40 days compulsory.
That would have been amazing material for this.
I mean,
exposing.
There are classes, there are people pay so that they can be coached into get into these programs. It's that kind of thing. There's like some context, 10% or 12% they charge of your total stipend. It's that bad. And then even if the applicants, these are just the applicants, but in the end, as I said, only hardly 10 or 15 people get in because they are ineligible to the terms and conditions that are set by the organizations, mostly because of the limitations that are there, like attendance criteria. Like Outreach has 40 days compulsory leave, 40 days gap should be there, but then that is not possible in many universities, and they won't even give you that. They won't support.
I mean, I'll admit, so Outreach happens like twice a year, and they kind of changed their rules somewhere when I started applying last year, and they said that only if you're an Indian or you're from the Northern Hemisphere, you can apply only in the May, in the summer round, and not in the December round. And that just changed when I decided to apply in the December round, and I was so heartbroken. So I just tried to manipulate my timing so that I could get selected, but it just didn't work out. So I would also like to say, like, so I was talking about abusing all these good, noble initiatives that people thought would help developing countries. So what's happening is, like, we have so many scholarships for girls that promote open source contributions or just participation in global coding competitions. And what the perks are of these is that you get to attend conferences, and the most basic example of this is a Google conference, an Anita Borg or Grace Hopper conference. But to get eligible to get to that conference, you have to clear the coding round, which is on a global platform, and therefore it's really competitive. So I have personally known so many people, girls, who have made boys who are amazing coders do write these tests, because these are all online, so no one knows who's writing these tests. They clear, they get amazing ranks, and they go there for free. It's just past the point where I do not know how much diversity outreach are you doing, and people have no idea how to distinguish where the diversity part is coming in and where's the abusing part coming in. Like, they have no way of distinguishing or preventing that, and I think that's something that needs to be worked upon.
And it's not just attending conferences. They only want to attend conferences because they get to brag about it, and it's, you get a free tour. That's it.
So, like, what's happening over here, there are open source organizations. I don't know if I should really name them, but there is a lot of
nepotism
and
corruption going on in certain organizations which we choose not to name.
These come from people who are on really high posts, and these organizations aren't some small open source, or
they're really large organizations.
Right, and what they do is I feel that if you're a GSOC intern in one organization. So here's the basic line. In India, you just saw the statistics. There's so many contributors. That means there's so much competition in India in spite of all the limitations. So we have to basically break through all that to get in. Now we have these organizations that offer previous GSOC interns to work on the same project again, even though they haven't contributed for over a year. And then there are these new GSOC developers who are trying to get into the program, but they just do not know what's happening behind the curtain. So it just got harder to hardest to just get in. So what should be done is that A, people, employers just start recognizing OSS contributions. I know Red Hat, we were talking, and then I know the Red Hat does
Red Hat is like recognize, awesome.
Right, so they recognize OSS contributions if they're listed on the resume. In India, it has started to happen, but you would see this culture in startups. So that's really prevalent. They look for open source contributions.
And
they value
not
it.
It's just limited to India. It's like Indonesia, Singapore,
right,
Japan.
Yeah, and basically whatever we talked about till now, that needs to be done. We need extra credits for our project.
More stricter checks in open source programs on mentors from these regions, because I mean really some bad things are happening. I mean, we don't choose to name some orgs, but
the point is we won't choose to name it now, but just no one does anything about it, because maybe they're scared, maybe they don't care, I don't know, but it's really affecting a huge population of new contributors, I'd like to say. Yeah,
and even universities should begin to support students now. Because, I mean, it's hurting students in the end, because even though, like, there are, like, how many, 100K some graduates of engineering every year, that graduate students, but then the problem is hardly 1% of them get employed, and that's because they lack skills, and the only reason they lack actual skills are they don't get to experience what actual software engineering is before in college itself, so no one is going to hire them.
Right, so solid, more solid talking point, we held a survey, a mini survey. Can you just show that?
Yes.
So we randomly asked people to fill out a form, tell them their views. These aren't a lot of responses, but this is all we could get, so let's work with it. The question was, country you're from. India, two from the United States. One of them is Justin W. Flory. do they contribute to open source? Does your university value open source contributions? Yeah. So why the yes is coming is because now there are people who are going from colleges, so if college doesn't support it, they rebel and then they talk about it in their own held workshops in university classrooms without telling the college administration. So yeah, people are aware, definitely. Okay, next. Have you ever gotten a job because of your open source contributions? Most would say no. I said a yes, because that's how I got my job. And like I mentioned, it was a startup, and they value open source contributions. They value integrating open source products, so yay. Does your university give extra course credits? No, that's not happening. The one, I'm definitely sure that's Justin, who...
No, that's also me.
Oh, that's you. With a yes?
Yes.
Typical. that's pretty much it. Then there were just people talking about what all they've contributed to.
And then these are the orgs.
Zulip, FOSS Asia, Koala, Simpai, Fedora, OpenCore, lots and lots.
Like, just started this one, just started to contribute on GitHub randomly.
Works. It's open source.
I mean, most people do begin contributions, but once they realize the time limitations and everything that comes in, they stop.
Actually, why they stop is because they know that's not how they're going to get into Google. That's definitely not, because Google has data structures, and they ask competitive coding and dynamic programming.
That's okay, but if you are at the start itself grading students based on their mark sheet and not even letting them in for the interview, however good their others, like actual software engineering skills may be, not just Google, like every other company in India, then I mean,
yeah. So that was
at least Google is now supporting. I mean, Google now supports it. Google does not check if you directly do when you directly apply. They don't ask for your mark sheet that much, and they look after all your other skills, but all other companies, I mean, they just don't.
So I think that's all from our side. Thanks for hearing our rants. I hope something happens on this. Anyone has anything to add to this?
if you want to reach out to us, I'm Pac23 on GitHub and same on Twitter.